From your second volume, that is dual nature of radiation and matter. So dual nature. What is a dual? Dual means it is for light which has two nature. One is a wave nature, another one is particle nature. So both the things we are going to see for a light and how the light interacts with the matter. Okay? So we know that light is an electromagnetic radiations. So what is a light? Light is nothing but and electromagnetic waves. So before 19th century, electricity and magnetism both also different. Okay, so before 19th century, electricity and magnetism both also different. But many revolution takes place at the end of 19th century. So particularly in 1895. Rontgen discovered X-ray. After that, in the year 1897, J.K. Thomson, he discovered an electron. So how this discovery is made? So what are the things that begin this discovery? So to produce an X-ray and this electron, so we need a high voltage and a low pressure. High voltage and a low pressure. Okay, so how they created X-ray? So now we are going to see the production of X-ray. So we know that the principle is high voltage and a low pressure. So Rontgen, we have a special device that is a thick walled glass tube. The thick walled glass tube is highly evaporated. The thick walled glass tube is highly evaporated. And inside the glass tube, two electrodes are kept. One is a cathode and another one is anode. One is a cathode, another one is anode. And this is evaporated tube. Then with Maxwell and Hertz. And Hertz discovered, he produced and he analyzed the electromagnetic waves. Okay. all the introductions. So in this lesson, dual nature of radiations and matter. The dual nature means the light which has a two nature. What are the two nature? One is the wave nature, another one is particle nature. Okay, the dual nature of radiations and matter. So how it is going to interact with the matter? Okay. So before 19th century, the electricity and magnetism were also separate field. But at the end of 19th century, the electricity and magnetism were unified. So which is called as electromagnetism. So the unification done by Maxwell and Hertz. Okay. At first, in the year 1895, W.C. Rontgen discovered an X-ray. So to produce an X-ray, we need a low pressure and a high voltage. Okay. So the second topic is electron emission. Electron emissions. Basically, we know that materials are classified into three types. What are the three types? Conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. But the conductors, best example is metals. Okay. So metals are the best example for the conductors. So what makes the conductivity in this metal? Because the metal has free electrons. Okay. The metal has free electrons. Let us assume this metal. So these metals contain some free electrons. So what are free electrons? It's a valence electrons. Okay, that is excess electrons. So these the conductivity is mostly done and carried out with these free electrons only. Suppose if you are trying to remove this free electron from the metal surface, what happens? Is it possible to remove the metal surface? No, normally it is not possible. Suppose if you are trying to remove this free electron from the metal surface, the metal contains uniformly distributed positive charge. We know that. So the surface positive charge will pull back these electrons. So the electrons normally cannot leave from the metal surface. So how can we remove it? So for this, we have certain process. So how to remove the free electron from the metals? For that, we should supply the external energy. When an external energy is given to this metal surface, so from the energy, the part of the energy given to this free electron against element, okay, against the restraining forces, okay. So that is called work functions. What is it? Work functions. So now from the electron emissions, we are going to learn one term, that is work function. That is denoted by the letter pi naught. So what is a work function? That is minimum energy given to the free electron from the metal surface to escape from the surface is called work functions. Okay, and the work function unit is electron volt. Work function unit is electron volt. So what is the value of electron volt? We know that the charge of an electron is, what's the charge of an electron? 1.9 into 10 to the power minus 31 and coulomb and 1 volt. Okay. So finally we get the value is 1.9 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay. So this is the value of 1 electron volt. So 1 electron volt is equal to 1.9 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay. So again I repeat the work functions. What is the work function? The definition is a minimum energy given to a free electron so as to escape from a metal surface. That is called as work function. Okay. So the first two definitions we have studied is work function. So work function, it is a characteristic property of material, not for an electron. Note it, that is a very important point. So work function, it is a characteristic property of the material, that is the metal which we use, because different metal have a different work functions, that we are going to see next. Okay. So note that it is a characteristic property of a material. And not a metal. Sorry, and not an electron. And not for an electron. It is a characteristic property of a material. Here material is a metal. Okay. So again I am going to repeat. So electron emissions. So can we move an electron from the metal surface? Because the free electrons mostly are on the metal surfaces, but normally the electrons cannot be removed by itself. Suppose if electron tries to escape from the metal surface, the positive charge in the metal will appear and bring back this electron same to the material, that is a metal. So how can we remove an electron? So for that we need external energy. The external energy given to this metal surface, in that a minimum energy from the external source on the metal surface, which is given to the electron, which is removed from the metal surface, is called work functions. So the work function is different for different material, and work function is denoted by the letter pi naught. And the SI unit of work function is electron volt. Okay, what is the value of electron volt? That is, one electron volt is equal to 1.9 × 10⁻¹⁹ joule. Which means, to accelerate an electron, if we give 1 volt potential, then the one electron volt value is said to be this value. And work function is a characteristic property of the material and not for an electron. Okay. And before that, in the introduction I said that J.J. Thomson discovered electrons, and who discovered X-ray first? Roger. Okay, right? Also, J.J. Thomson estimated charge mass ratio. So J.J. Thomson also estimated charge mass ratio, charge to mass ratio, that is E by M. So what is the value of E by M? We know the value. What is the charge of an electron? 1.6 × 10⁻¹⁹ coulomb, and the mass of an electron is 9.1 × 10⁻³⁹ kilogram, and the value is 1.76 × 10⁻¹⁰ coulomb kilogram inverse. So this is the value of charge mass ratio. Okay. So J.J. Thomson estimated. He is the first person estimated charge mass ratio. The value is 1.76 × 10⁻¹⁰ coulomb per kilogram or kilogram inverse. Okay. After that, Crookes discovered the cathode rays. Okay. So second person is J.J. Thomson. After that, Crookes. William Crookes. So William Crookes, he discovered cathode rays. So like this, the technology, after that only many technological revolutions take place, many discoveries. Okay. So once again we come back to electron emissions. So normally the electron cannot escape from the metal surface because of the positive charge which bring back the electrons. So we must supply the external energy. So the external energy on this metal surface. External energy on this metal surface given to it, which remove an electrons. So these electrons are called photoelectrons. So what is the name of these electrons? Photoelectrons. So in how many ways we can remove an electron from the metal surface? There are three methods to emit the electron emissions. Before doing it, as I said already, the work function is a characteristic property of a material, not for an electron. And it is different for different material. Okay? So phi naught value is different for different material. Phi naught is different for different material. Material is not something but metals. So it is least for cesium. Least for cesium, and the value is 2.14 electron volt, and it is highest for platinum. Highest for platinum. Okay. Then electron emissions. So there are three ways we can emit this electrons. So what are the three ways? First one is field emission, so thermionic emission. And second process is field emission. And third process is photoelectric emission. Photoelectric emission. So first, thermionic emissions. So what is a thermionic emission? We know the word thermal. Thermal means heat. Okay? To a metal, when heat energy is supplied, what happens? The free electrons get vibrated and then released out from the metal. The free electrons get vibrated due to external heat energy, and then by the vibrations in the crystal arises, then escape out from the metals. So by supplying the heat energy, we can remove an electron from the metal surface. Hence the process is called thermionic emission. Which means thermionic emission means by heat to a metal. The second one is field emission. So field means there are two fields, you know that. One is an electric field and the one is magnetic field. So by giving a strong electric field or a magnetic field to a metal, we may release an electron. Okay? So field emission means by a strong electric field or a magnetic field. Okay? And then photoelectric emissions. What is photoelectric emissions? Let's see there. The third process is photoelectric emissions. So what is a photoelectric emission? So this is very important things. From this topic only the lesson begins. Okay. So photoelectric emissions, the simple introduction alone. So there is a it is similar like a production of X-rays. So to produce an X-ray, we need a high voltage and low pressure, no? Yes. In the same phenomena, in a vacuum tube, highly discharged vacuum tube, one side a cathode and another one side an anode is kept. Okay? From this, when a light of suitable frequency, a light source, this is a source. So when a light of suitable frequency falls on the metal surface, that ejects an electron. Okay? And externally these cathodes are connected to a different potential. This is a high tension battery, that is high voltage battery, and this is a rheostat. Okay? And this is a vacuum tube, evaporated tube. Okay, so from the source, when a light of suitable frequency, note that this is very important, that when a light of suitable frequency from the source that allows to falls on this metal surface, that is from the cathodes, that emit a high energy electrons. So because of this light interact with the matter, an electron emission takes place. So this interactions, the incident light is called photons. What is the name of it? Photons. The photons have a suitable energy, that is E is equal to h nu. This is already we have studied, no? Okay. So when a light of suitable frequency, that is a suitable energy, falls on this metal surface, the metal that eject an electrons, that is high energy electrons. So these electrons pass through this metal surface when a light of suitable frequency falls. So the corresponding electrons are called photoelectrons. So it is called as photoelectrons. So hence the process is called photoelectric emissions. Okay. So once again we recall electron emissions. In three ways we can emit an electrons. The first one is thermionic emissions, second one is field emission, third one is photoelectric emissions. So what is a thermionic emissions? To a metal surface, by supplying the high energy of a heat is given, then this heat energy which makes an electron to vibrate, so because of this vibration, the electron can escape from the metal surface. Then the second method is field emission. So what is a field emission? By giving a strong electric field or magnetic field to a metal, an electron emission takes place. So the process is called field emissions. And third one is photoelectric emissions. This is very, very important things. So this concept only we are going to learn in the upcoming classes. So photoelectric emissions. So the interaction of photons with the matter, that is a radiation with the matter, that emits a particle nature. Okay? So for that we need an equally evaporated glass tube and fitted with a cathode and anode. So the cathode is connected with the negative terminal, anode is a metal plate connected with the pass tube. So when the light of suitable frequency falls on this metal surface, what happened? Already it is in mode function. So within a less fraction of a second, the metal surface that absorbs the energy from the incident light again beyond the mode functions, and then the remaining energy given to this electron, free electron from the metal surface, thereafter the free electrons which is escape out from the metal surface. So these free electrons which is escape from the metal surface is called photoelectrons, because the electrons pass through into photons. So the electrons is called as photoelectrons. Okay? So the process is nothing but when a light of suitable frequency falls on the metal surface, so beyond the work functions, then the metal surface acquires energy. Soon after it ejects the electrons. Then the electrons, high energy electrons passing towards an anode, after that there will be a current produced in it. So these high energy electrons are called photoelectrons. Okay. So photon is totally different from photoelectrons. So photons, it's a wave nature, and the photoelectron is particle nature. So the two natures that comes here. The photons, it is a wave nature, and the photoelectron is in particle nature. That's what in the beginning they studied, dual nature. Okay. So dual means two nature, wave nature and then particle nature. Okay, once again we will recall what we are studying from the lessons. In the introduction, we have said that after the 18th century end only, the revolution takes place, particularly the unification of electromagnetism done by Hertz and Maxwell. Okay, so Rontgen discovered an X-ray, and then J.J. Thomson discovered an electron, and Crookes discovered a cathode rays. Then J.J. Thomson is the first person who estimated the charge mass ratio. What is the charge mass ratio? 1.76 into 10 to the power 11 coulomb per kilogram inverse. Okay. And then electron emissions. For that we are learning the important definition, work function. So what is the work function? The work function, it is a characteristics property of the material, not for an electron. Okay. Because normally from the imaging, this is a metal. The metal has free electrons. The free electrons is the valence electrons, it moves there and here. It is responsible for the conductivity. Okay? But normally we cannot remove an electron from the metal surface. So how to remove an electron from the metal surface? Now, we should supply some external energy. When an external energy is given to the metal surface, then the work function limit, it absorbs some energy from the incident light. After that, the electrons are ejected from the metals. So from the incident energy of the photons, the electrons are ejected. So because of the photons, the photoelectrons are produced. So for that, there is some limit. So there is a work function limit. So then only I said that the work, for different material, the work function is different, and it is least for cesium, and it is maximum for platinum. And cesium, the value is 2.14 electron volt, and for platinum, it is highest, that is 5.65 something electron volt. Okay. And then three ways we can emit an electron. Okay, these are the three ways. Thermionic emission, field emissions, and then photoelectric emissions. Okay, mainly the photoelectric emissions only we are going to learn very deeply. So, according to the photoelectric emissions, we must require low pressure and a high voltage. Okay, so when a high voltage is given to the cathode and anode, on a cathode, Okay, coming to the photoelectric effect, the two observations are made by the two different scientists. The first observation by Hetz and the second observation by Alvox and Lennard. So Hetz's observation also similar. He used only one type of material. He used only zinc material. So zinc. Okay, because already we know that the work function is different for different material. So using zinc, he made the experiments. So from a cathode, when a light of photon frequency falls, when a light of photon frequency falls on this cathode, which ejects an electrons, which moves towards an anode. Okay. After that, the work function limit. We are going to learn one other one terms. That must be a certain frequency on this metal surface to an ejecting electrons. So that is called threshold frequency. Threshold frequency. So what is the threshold frequency? That is nu naught. We know that solar panel, because solar panel works only at the daytime in the presence of sunlight. The solar panel is made in the form of semiconductors. Mostly germanium and silicon are there, that you are going to learn in the 14th chapter, last chapters. So on the semiconductor material, when the sunlight falls, only in the presence of sunlight, which is trying this semiconductor material, there is a connectivity between this diode, which will produce an electron. So the light energy is converted into electrical energy. The same process, when a light of photon frequency falls on this metal surface, that ejects electrons. So there must be a certain frequency, because the photoelectric effect full of frequency dependent. It is full of frequency. So it is full of frequency dependent. Okay. So there must be a minimum certain frequency in which the photoelectric emission begins. Below the frequency limit, photoelectric emission does not take place. So the particular corresponding frequency limit is called threshold frequency. So what is the definition of threshold frequency? A minimum frequency from which a metal surface ejects an electron below the frequency limit, no electron ejection takes place. So the particular frequency is called threshold frequency. So below the threshold frequency of the incident light, no photoelectrons. So for that, the incident light frequency should be greater than threshold frequency. Then only the photoelectric emission takes place. Suppose if the incident light frequency is less than the threshold frequency, there is no emission. So there must be a frequency exist in this case. So the corresponding frequency is called threshold frequency. Okay. So he used zinc and also some other material also responds, because the zinc, not only the zinc, some other materials, zinc, cadmium and magnesium. These materials respond to the high frequency incident light. What is the high frequency incident light? The high frequency incident light. So like ultraviolet. Ultraviolet. Okay. So the zinc, cadmium, magnesium, that is responsible for the high frequency light, that is ultraviolet. But some other materials are there, alkali metals. Alkali metals like lithium, sodium, potassium, etc. So these materials respond visible light. Visible light na our range, vidya. Responds in visible light. Visible light na vidya. It was sealed with a quartz membrane. So quartz membrane. Okay. And it was externally connected with the high voltage along with the rheostat. Okay. But some other modification also we can make this here. We can a little modify this case alone. We use a 6-way commutator. This is a 6-way commutator. Okay, from the Leonard and Arnold and Leonard observations, we are seeing it depends on 4 factors. First one is intensity. The second one is frequency. The third one is potential between cathode and anode, and fourth one is length of the material. Okay, so all these 4 factors we are going to see graphically and experimentally. So from the experimental analysis, by drawing a graph, we are going to understand the factors in which the photocurrent depends on. So the first one is intensity. Okay, so effect of intensity of photocurrent. So initially the cathode is maintained with negative potential and the anode is maintained with the positive potential, and this externally connected with the 6-way commutator. We know that it is a 6-way commutator, and the function of commutator is used to reverse the direction of the current between the cathode and the anode, and then parallel it is connected to a ohmmeter and seriously connected to a micrometer. Why we use micrometer instead of ammeter? Because here the photocurrent produced is not very large, only very less. So to measure the less photocurrent, we can use only the sensible ammeter. That's why we are using sensible ammeter instead of ammeter. And further it is connected to a rheostat and the battery potential. Okay. So for that characteristics, we use the 3 different intensity. For a first intensity I1, we use a less power rated bulb, that is 100 watts. And the second case, intensity I2, we double the power, so nearly 250 watts. And third high intensity, we use approximately 500 watts power. So first, you choose first intensity I1, that is UV source, intensity I1. And the cathode is maintained with the negative potential, anode is maintained with the positive potential. So when a light of suitable frequency falls on this metal surface, okay, the first characteristics, that is effect of intensity of photocurrent. So for this, we use the 3 different intensity of sources. The first intensity, we use a less power rated bulb, and second intensity, we use a double the power than the first case, and third intensity, we use a very high power rated. So for first case, there is intensity I1. When a light of suitable frequency falls on the metal surface, the cathode is maintained with negative potential and anode is maintained with positive potential. So above the threshold frequency for the incident light, the photoelectrons are produced, and then what happens? The high energy electrons, photoelectrons attracted towards an anode, there is a photocurrent is produced. So we are going to plot the graph between collector plate potential. What is collector plate? So here the cathode is called emitter because that emits an electron. So cathode is called an emitter, and anode is called a collector because it receives an electron. So it is called collector plate. And cathode is called emitter plate. So the emitter plate cathode emits an electron, and collector plate receives photoelectrons. So there is a photocurrent is produced. So how much potential we are maintaining across the cathode and anode? For that, how much photocurrent is induced? So gradually we are increasing the potential from 0. The photocurrent also increases linearly up to a certain point, and then stop producing, that is it gets saturated. So this is for the intensity I1. So it gets over. So for the maximum potential, it gets saturated after the certain point. Now stop increasing the voltage. Now just reduce the voltage and again bring back and reverse the commutator. While you're reversing the commutator, now for cathode you are maintaining with the positive potential, and for anode negative potential. So gradually increase it. The negative potential gradually increases. The photocurrent also gradually reduces. At a certain point, it stops. Okay. That is, by reversing the commutator in a certain negative potentials, the photocurrent almost stops, which means now the cathode is positive. Already the photoelectrons are produced, but the only not all the electrons reaches towards anode in this case. Only the few electrons and few high energy electrons are not able to reach this anode site. So, what is the maximum kinetic energy of these photoelectrons? In this case, the maximum kinetic energy of this photoelectron is electron is negative charge and the potential also negative potential. So, E V naught. So, the maximum kinetic energy of the photoelectrons which is able to reach the anode site is E V naught. Here E is photoelectrons, electronic charge, and V naught is the negative potential, applied potential. But note that below a certain value, in a certain negative potential, there is no photocurrent. Okay? That's it. So the first intensity case over. Now we are going to choose the second intensity case. So for the second intensity case, we are increasing the power, but we didn't change the source. It remains ultraviolet. We didn't change the source, but we increase only the intensity. So first case we may use 100 watts, and this case we are using 200 watts technical. Okay? So once again repeat the experiments. So now maintain the emitter plate with the negative potential and collection plate with the positive potential, and gradually by adjusting the rheostat, increase the intensity. So gradually increasing the intensity. But after a certain point, it almost stops. So this is the second case intensity, I2. Once again, stop increasing and then reverse the commutator. And for the cathode now is positive potential, anode is negative potential. Repeat the experiment in negative directions. Once again, you can note that it gradually reduces and stops at the same point. Okay? Then, once again, reverse the commutator. After reversing the commutator, now maintain like the first case, cathode with the negative potential, anode with the positive potential. Now the intensity is IT. That is high power rated bulb. So in the high power rated bulb, we didn't change the source. It remains ultraviolet only. Okay. So in this third intensity cases, once again, by adjusting the rheostat, increasing the potential, you can see that the curve comes like this. So in all the cases, you can note that in a certain point it stops. So in this point, it is called saturated current. So it is saturated. After that, how much do we increase the potential also? The photocurrent is, that's it. So this is saturated current. And once again, reverse the commutator, maintain cathode with the positive potential, anode with the negative potential. In reverse directions, when you are doing the same length, it stops in the same point. So for all the cases, so even for a different intensity of the light, for a different intensity of light, the stopping potential is same. So what you can conclude from this? The photocurrent is independent of the intensity. So conclusion is, from the experimental conclusions, the photocurrent is independent of intensity. So experimentally we have confirmed that the photoelectric current, it is different for different material, but it is independent for the intensity. Whatever may be the intensity, but there must exist a certain threshold frequency. Okay? So above the threshold frequency only the photoelectric emission begins. Below the threshold frequency, the photoelectric emission does not take place. So photoelectric emission is independent of intensity. So first characteristics over. The second one we are going to see is frequency. So effect of frequency on photocurrent. Second case is effect of frequency on example, large, in only a simple example. So for orange the frequency is mu 1, and for second frequency we use a green, that is mu 2, and third one is a blue. For the frequency is mu 3. So while using the first frequency, how they effect a photocurrents? Okay, so first frequency, intensity is fixed, intensity remains I, but first case we use the frequency mu 1. Okay, so again this emitter plate is negative and the collector plate is positive, the same process, gradually increase the potential. You can note that at a certain point it gets saturated, so the curve will come like this. Okay, so this is the frequency mu 1, and intensity also remains same. Now reverse the commutator, repeat the experiment, so the potential also can differ, so we get one value. So this is for the first frequency, we'll get the starting potential minus V0 1, because negative potential. After that photocurrent also starts. Now we are going to use the second light, that is the green light. So for a green light of the frequency mu 2, reverse the commutator, again change the terminal, the cathode is negative and anode is positive, then gradually increase it. The photocurrent also increases, after a certain point it gets saturated. Okay, now using commutator, reverse the terminal, cathode with the positive, anode with the negative, in the negative directions you will get the point like this. So here the second starting potential is a V02. So corresponding frequency is mu 2. Now reverse the terminal using commutator. Now the cathode is negative, anode is positive. Now the third frequency of light, what is light? Third light we use blue light. So for blue light, you can see that. So gradually increasing the voltage, you will get the curve like this. After that it gets saturated. So here you can see that after a certain value, it is saturated. The current is saturated. So here beyond a certain level, but in the negative direction you can see that. So reverse the commutator. Now cathode with the positive, anode with the negative. That's how you get here. So V3. So minus V3. So third case frequency is greater than second case. Second case frequency is greater than the first case. Okay, right? So a different frequency of light, we have a different starting potential. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion number 2 is photocurrent is frequency dependent. Okay. What is the second conclusion? Photocurrent is frequency dependent. So it is, photoelectric emission is independent of intensity, but it depends on frequency. We know that in MOOC also they ask some questions. What is the question now? In the visible light, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. We have a 7 colors now. So in that they are choosing 3 different colors. One is the red, another one is green, I think, and then third one is blue color. So out of these 3 colors, blue, green, and then red, in which color photoelectric emission begins now? It is maximum for blue and less for green, and photoelectric emission does not exist in red, because red has high wavelength, but we must need a high frequency. So the high frequency light is only the blue. So the blue light, it is near to ultraviolet, because the below the blue region is called ultraviolet. That's what, because of that we are using ultraviolet light in a photoelectric emission process. Okay, so UV light only mostly we are using. So photoelectric emission is frequency dependent. So for the third graph we draw here. then it is different for different material. So that is also we know that. If, even work function also different for different material. So for different materials, what is that is?
Yes.
So for that, for first material, this is a gap because I can know a material A and there must be a threshold frequency. So the gap should be parted between the starting potential and the incident light frequency mu. So the gap is called V naught mu gap. V naught mu gap. V naught is starting potential, mu is incident light frequency. So this is for first material. So mu should be greater than mu naught. And for second material also the curve like this. This is second material. And if this is mu naught, what is this threshold frequency mu naught as? So for this mu gap should be greater than mu naught as. Okay. So it, from this we can conclude that it is different for different material. So the four factors we can cover. And what are the four factors? It is independent of the intensity and the potential between the cathode and anode, and frequency dependent and nature of the material. For different material, that have a different work function as well as they have a different values too. Okay. Next one is classical negativity. Why it is failure? So why classical negativity is failure to explain? Because after the in the beginning of 19th century and the end of 18th century only electromagnetism was unified. Before that, classical negativity is wrong. If you use a classical negativity, according to classical negativity, the first wrong point is from the incident light, the metal that is cathode continuously absorbs energy. It takes several hours even, and then only emits electrons. So what is the first wrong point? So material get continuously absorbs energy. Material get continuously absorbs energy from incident light. Even it may take hours. Even it may take hours to emit photoelectrons. And then this is the first wrong point. Then whatever may be the frequency descent. Whatever may be the frequency. Which means threshold frequency. So about the threshold frequency, the classical negativity is failure to explain. So this was a wrong statement. What's the first point? It says from the incident light continuously the material absorbs energy. So that is for work function limit, it takes even several hours. After that only it emits an electron. And whatever may be the frequency, this was a wrong statement. The next one. By this process, even if it may take some hours, but actually photoelectric emission is an instantaneous process. So what is the instantaneous process? Once the light of suitable frequency falls on the metal surface, within a less fraction of a second, the electrons are ejected. Less fraction of a second, from this experiment you can see that the light of suitable materials continuously absorb energy from the incident light, even if it takes half changing the photoelectrons, whatever may be the frequency, they said that. But actually, there must exist a frequency. What is the frequency? Threshold frequency. They further explain threshold frequency. This is very, very important. They didn't say anything about threshold frequency. The next one is time dependent. So, because of this phenomenon, because of these points from classical wave theory, which is totally not obeying the photoelectric effects. But external events are given. Okay? So, already they asked questions. In the course, they asked questions why classical wave theory is able to explain photoelectric effects. These are the points. So, we will work what we are studying now. So, the important definitions are defined work function. Define work functions. The second one, threshold frequency. Then photoelectric emission effect. What is the photoelectric effect? And then stopping potential. That is V naught. What is the V naught? Stopping potential. And then loss of photoelectric. What are the laws of photoelectric effect? What we studied experimentally, these are the laws of photoelectric effects. The gap notes, four gap. What is four gap? It is different for different material. First material, second material. Material A, material B, and this is V naught, this is mu naught. So mu naught dash. Okay. So the four points we have covered. So this comes loss of photoelectric effect. Okay. So the four laws are very important. So it was given points in your book. So the four laws you know that. And then what is the work functions? And what is the essential work function? It is electron rule. Okay. And what is the threshold frequency? And then defined photoelectric effect, then stopping potential, the loss of photoelectric effect. Okay.
Thank you. இல்லை இல்லை
எது ஸ்டாப் பண்ணுறது நீ 7 நிமிஷம்